Well, my name is Postras Pandey. I'm chairman of South Asia Watson Trade Economics and Environment, SAUTI, based in Kathmandu, and the organizer of this session, Challenges in Implementation and Financing of Trade Facilitation Agreement, TFA. Well, as all of you know, the issue of trade facilitation formally entered into WTO agenda at the Singapore Ministerial Conference in December 1996. But the mandate of that ministerial conference was fairly limited, which directed WTO Goods Council to undertake exploratory and analytical work on the simplification of trade procedures in order to assess the scope of the WTO rules in this area. However, it was in 2001 Doha Ministerial Conference, it got a step closer to the negotiating track, and only in 2004, the negotiating mandate was crystallized to review, as appropriate, clarify and improve relevant aspects of three provisions of GATT. That is Article 5, Freedom of Transit, Article 8, Fees and Formalities Connected with Importation and Exportation, and Article 10, Publication and Administration of Trade Regulation. The Ninth Ministerial Conference in Bali in December 2013 adopted Trade Facilitation Agreement. In fact, this TFA, Trade Facilitation Agreement, is the first multilateral agreement since the establishment of WTO in 1995. The basic objective of this trade facilitation agreement is to expedite the movement, release, and clearance of goods, including transit in goods, and thereby reducing the trade cost. The agreement itself has 13 articles covering substantive areas of transparency, particularly with regard to the trade rules, appeal review procedures, discipline and fees and charges imposed on or in connection with exportation and importation, release and clearance of goods, goods in transit and freedom of transit, customs cooperation, among other issues. The most striking feature of this agreement, trade facilitation agreement, is that unlike other WTO agreement and GATT's provision, this agreement allows for the self-determination of timeframes and implementation capacities for the application of its discipline on a country-by-country and provision-by-provision basis. Members are free to have their own implementation plan by designating specific measures under category A, meaning implementation upon entry into force, under category B, that is implementation after certain transition period, and category C, requiring the acquisition of implementation capacity through provision of assistance and support from the development partners. And if you look at the available literature, it is estimated, and particularly WTO publication estimates, that the full implementation of TFA, Trade Facilitation Agreement, could reduce global trade cost by an average of 14.3%. Similarly, the computable general equilibrium CG model is simulation predicts export gains from TFA between $750 billion to over $1 trillion. It is further projected that over the 2015-30 horizon, implementation of TFA will add around 2.7% per year to the old export growth, and more than 0.5% per year on old GDP. And here, developing countries are the main beneficiary of this implementation of trade facilitation agreement, as both exports and GDP growth will rise more in developing countries than developed countries. In addition to these direct benefits, implementation of TFA helps diversify exports, increase opportunity to participate in global value chain. It could attract foreign direct investment. It could improve revenue collection of developing countries. It could reduce the incidence of corruption. And it also ensures participation of the small and medium enterprises in international market. But the implementation of this TFA agreement is resource incentive, it's intensive. And the implementation cost, it depends on the initial development stage of the country, its size of the economy, the level of ambition, I mean, how fast are you going to implement various, I mean, agreement and measures. And again, I mean, it is quite difficult, I mean, to estimate the actual cost of implementation of TFA, as TFA measures are linked with other broader economic reform program. Nonetheless, I mean, some international organizations, including World Bank, UNCTAD, and OECD, indicate that full implementation of TFA may be well over $15 million. So out of this, I mean, there is an objection. Our question on the implementation of TFA is win-win strategy for both exporting country and importing country. But from the perspective of developing and least developed countries, there are, I mean, certain issues. And the issues are, how could developing and least developed countries maximize the benefit of implementing TFA? What should be the priorities for the implementation of various TFA measures by these countries? Or let me put it bluntly, how can we save trade facilitation agreement from becoming import facilitation agreement for developing and least developed countries? Another issues are least developed countries and developing countries ready institutionally, administratively, and financially to implement trade facilitation agreement? Another issues could be, what are the challenges, both external and internal, faced by the developing and least developed countries in implementation of TFA? And final issues could be, how development partners could assist developing and least developed countries in implementation of trade facilitation agreement. And with this background, let me turn to our panelist for the answer, I mean, to the questions, I mean, I raised over here. And we have three panelists. We have His Excellency Deepak Dhital, Ambassador and Permanent Representative of Nepal to the United Nations and other international organization. And we have Mia Mikic, she heads Trade Policy and Analysis Sections of Trade and Investment Division in the United Nations, SCAP. She also coordinates the Asia-Pacific Research and Training Network, ARTNET, an open network of research and academic institutions and think tank in Asia-Pacific. And before joining SCAP, she was Professor of International Economics at University of Zagreb and Senior Lecturer at the University of Auckland. Our third panelist, Dr. Christian Cross. She has been working at the WTO as Chief Coordinator of Enhanced Integrated Framework, EIF, a program supporting the integration of PLDCs into the global trading partner. Before joining EIF WTO, she worked for the World Bank at the headquarters as well as at country offices in Ethiopia and Kenya. Now I request His Excellency Ambassador Deepak Dhital for your comments or for your remarks on the issues. Sir, you have the floor.
Yes, thank you, Ms. Pandey, for asking me to be here and present something as a panelist. And my fellow panelists, Christian and Mia, and good afternoon, everybody. Well, the Trade Facilitation Agreement has been much in talks since it was adopted in 2013 in the Bali Ministerial Meeting of the WTO. And well, it has been termed as a landmark achievement in the history of WTO also. And well, there have been some very rosy pictures painted in favor of this TFA. And it is said that, you know, it substantially reduces trade costs, and more particularly in the developing countries and the LDCs. And the figures, the growth in the exports that is possible with the full implementation of TFA is quite staggering, as Dr. Pandey has already highlighted. Let me not really quote all these. Well, this, however, has both positive as well as some, you know, dark sides, gray areas as well. Well, it really depends upon the level of development of the country, the developed country perspective, and the developing country, those who are at a higher level of development, and those that are at the lower level, and also the perspective of LDCs and those of LLDCs. If you individually ask all these groups, they might have different understanding of the same concept. Even though, you know, some research findings, you know, they say the results will be good, win-win for everybody. The problem with developing countries and LDCs is that, well, there are so many development-oriented challenges which need to be addressed in totality. And Trade Facilitation Agreement, as it stands today, you know, in terms of facilitating cross-border flow of merchandise, it can prove as window dressing only if we do not address some of the structural issues that are there in the countries, LDC countries like us. They need to have structural transformation of the economy. They have to address the supply side constraints, and also enhance the productive capacity in order to really meaningfully participate in the world trade. If we look at the scenario, their share is only 1.2% of the global total in terms of trade, in terms of total trade. And look at the population they have. Around 12% of the total population of the world. And the ambient environment, the prevailing environment, economic, social, and other environment, and the marginalization, all these mind-boggling issues are there. And in order to boost trade, especially export trade, we need to address by going to the generics. by really, you know, facilitating them to enhance their productive capacities in all potential areas. And there is, you know, the problem of policy adjustment, of making institutions, and also developing good infrastructure, social as well as economic, physical infrastructure, and then diversifying their production base also is very, very important. Otherwise, with small production base and limited items for exports, well, what benefit will they really achieve by implementing the TFA? Well, TFA in itself is not bad. It is a good concept. But it is only a small tip of the iceberg. It is, even though it is good for them also. And when Dr. Pandey was making his introductory comments, remarks, he mentioned that, you know, there is a likelihood that, you know, these countries might be, you know, besieged by a situation of, you know, this agreement being import facilitation agreement, within quote. Well, let me give you a picture from my own country, Nepal. Well, Nepal joined WTO back in 2004, and at the time of joining WTO, our export, excuse me, just a moment. Our export used to be 0.58 billion US dollar equivalent. And the import at that time, it surpassed, of course, export, but it was not much, 1.48 billion US dollar. And at the time, the import-export ratio was around 1:3.5. And in the course of time, in our fiscal year 2013-14, exports was more or less the same level. It didn't even reach 1 billion US dollar. It went up to 0.91 billion US dollar. Whereas import, it ballooned to 7.22 billion US dollar. So now the export-import ratio is 1:9. Is this sustainable? Can we stand? And imports, you know, if we just go on importing more and more and don't have any diversified export base and products that is sellable in the market, so what will be the situation? We'll be further marginalized. The vulnerability will increase. And mere window dressing, you know, in terms of just facilitating and enhancing the efficiency of the customs checkpoint, is it going to help us? That's the question. So we stress that the Doha Development Agenda, with all these important pillars, be faithfully implemented so that, you know, developing countries as well as LDCs, they get full benefit out of it. And we say that, you know, TFA, it has come out good, but it it is not to the extent that, you know, it has been, it has been mentioned by some reports that, you know, it will be a kind of panacea, you know, for all those countries, and especially developing countries and LDCs. It will help, but, you know, we have to work very closely together. One concept that I like about this TFA is that, you know, it has given a lot of flexibilities to all these countries, including LDCs and developing countries, in terms of implementation and the measures that they are going to take, and the different provisions, how they are going to implement them. It has given a lot of flexibility. And it has also created some institutional mechanisms like trade TFA facility. So we don't know, you know, if we look at it now, you know, it is very modest, and the kind of budget that it has, you know, it is hardly enough to really fulfill the burgeoning needs of, for example, you know, creation of infrastructure. That is the most crucial part, along with administrative and procedural reform that is mentioned in the TFA. We need to go deeper and create good institutions, policies, and infrastructures so that it enhances the productive capacity. And then only you have some products that is matching to the market. So for this, you know, to addressing these needs, I think the donors and the countries, concerned countries, developing countries and LDCs, they have to work closely together. And there is a kind of concept of matchmaking by Trade Facilitation Facility, which is will be located at the WTO. And well, I wonder, you know, in our time of so much constraints in financial resources and the competing and pressing demands in so many areas, like the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, the SDGs, it has been adopted. It is such an ambitious program covering the entire population, the inclusive agenda. And of course, you know, the climate change is another formidable challenge, and it's a life and death question for many countries and many communities. And well, does TFA attract sufficient financing, you know, to really implement this? That is also questionable. Well, you can identify your needs. That will not be that difficult. But if you really want to facilitate trade, you know, in the LDCs or LLDCs, which are further handicapped because of their geographic constraints and lack of access to the sea and to the international market. So, you know, does this facility, you know, is it possible to be linked into the whole development process? You know, then only it will be in a position to really give results to countries like us. And so in order to make it a win-win, I think the developed countries, all the donor communities, international organizations, they have to address the issues of LDCs and LLDCs and developing countries, depending upon the level of development, in a holistic manner. And TFA in itself, it is good. It delivers something, but there are certain conditions which will alone give you the products that is the export products that is sellable in the market. In itself, we are afraid, it might prove a one-way traffic of increasing import trade and putting much distress to vulnerable and marginalized countries, like all these LDCs. So that kind of risk is there. And so we want this facility, TFA, to be more ambitious than what has been said. Go beyond the border, not only border, but it has to be linked with those points where the real economic activities can be generated. And so we give equal emphasis on the creation of infrastructure, especially the transport and other industrial infrastructure. Then only the picture becomes complete. Otherwise, you will be just looking through the window, and it is a scene which you cannot really figure out. It means anything to anybody. Well, for developed countries where everything is in good order, it might be good. But initially there might be some benefit, but it won't be sustainable. That's true. So with these words, later on, if we have certain curiosities to every exchange, I'll be able to answer them. Now, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Dital, for bringing into the issues of development challenges faced by developing and least developed countries, the need for their structural transformation, and the need for addressing supply side constraints, and also needs for improving productive capacity, and also arguing that TFA in isolation would be in isolations without addressing Doha development agenda in totality, would be simply window dressing, and also highlighting the need for development of hard infrastructure on trade facilitations together with soft infrastructure, which is addressed to by TFA in the table. Now I invite Dr. Christian Krause for your views.
Thank you very much, moderator, for giving me the floor. And I'm very glad I can talk right after His Excellency, because some of the points that he raised and that I think are extremely relevant will hopefully be addressed by my intervention. I'm the chief coordinator at the EIF Executive Secretariat, and the EIF is the only aid for trade program exclusively dedicated to LDCs. So before looking at constraints to the implementation and financing of the Trade Facilitation Agreement, let me talk a bit about the EIF so you see where my insights come from. The EIF flagship publication or diagnostic is the Diagnostic Trade Integration Strategy that helps countries, LDCs, to identify the constraints for trade development, but also the opportunities. So we look at the constraints cross-cutting, such as trade facilitation, for example, but also institutional capacity. And then we look at constraints and at specific value chains, those that have the potential of providing good export results. So once this diagnostic is done, the countries look at the sort of government reform points that would be important to address, and what kind of support for capacity building is necessary, and put this together in a prioritized medium-term action plan. So medium-term, normally 3 to 5 years. So this is one way or one main instrument that the EIF provides to LDCs for trade development. The second one are multi-year projects for institutional capacity building. Usually sort of at the Ministry of Trade, they're anchored at the Ministry of Trade, but we look at the stakeholders. Which many of which are not at the Ministry of Trade, you know, those actually do the exporting and trading and producing are in the private sector. So these institutional capacity building programs aimed at strengthening the country's ability to manage their trade development agenda, then to bring trade into the bigger picture in their national development plan. And then to help them mobilize resources to address those capacity constraints identified in this DTIS flagship, and then to coordinate the delivery of trade-related assistance, because many bilateral and multilateral donors are working on certain areas, but it's not always a coordinated picture. We have such projects going in 37 of 48 LDCs. And then the third instrument that we have at our disposal is our projects to actually directly strengthen supply side. A lot of projects look at tourism, and the most important export services export for LDCs by far. Some look at value addition for cash crops. Others look actually at trade facilitation. So we have a range of projects. 25 were approved over the first period of the EIF program. What's important for us is that we build on national ownership of those projects. That means that the project proposals are not written by consultants, but they're written actually in the country, sometimes with the help of advisors, but by the government, or if it's a supply-side capacity building project, by the entity that implements it. And we use then, for these institutional capacity building projects, but also for the others, for the majority, we use national processes. Processes for procurement, for recruitment, and so on and so forth. So I've seen over the last 8 years that I've worked for this program some constraints for the implementation of the EIF program. And I will use that insight to extrapolate some constraints that I can see for the implementation of the TFA. Now, what I've also seen in these diagnostic trade integration studies is the enormous importance of trade facilitation constraints for LDCs in general, and those landlocked ones in particular. I have to say that when we look at trade facilitation, we look beyond what's covered in the Trade Facilitation Agreement, but that's, of course, a big part of trade facilitation already, but there are issues beyond. And in particular, I said for regional trade, this is a constraint. And I've heard in earlier panels, it's cheaper for Nestle to ship their products to Burkina Faso via London than directly from Côte d'Ivoire. I've also heard that going by container from Bangladesh to London is cheaper than by road to Nepal. So, regional trade is particularly affected by those constraints, and this is particularly bad news for LDCs in particular, because in regional trade, a larger fraction of regional trade is actually in manufacturers than, trade, overseas trade share of manufacturers. So, and having a vibrant manufacturing industry is very important for structural change. So, addressing these constraints is very, very good news for LDCs in a number of ways. They have the highest trade costs, so could make the biggest impact. And, for regional trade, this could unlock a source for the important structural change. So, but what are the challenges of implementation? From what I've seen in the LDCs, it's the capacity of the governments to drive forward these regulatory and institutional reforms. In some LDCs have relatively small ministries of trade or customs, where there's just not the manpower to, even if technical assistance is there, to drive this forward. So we need time and technical assistance. Yes, the TFA allows for a flexible schedule, but the sooner those reforms are done, the better. That's clear, so that the LDCs can benefit from them as soon as possible. So, particularly looking at the regulatory framework and ensuring consistency with other policies, this is something some LDCs might struggle and need sort of early on technical assistance. Also, if new departments need to be set up for post-clearance and risk management or central anchoring point, these are things that need to be planned very well and sequenced very well. Then the second constraint for implementation I would see in the sort of setting it up, that was for sort of setting up the preparatory work, but then for actual implementation and enforcement, for that you need political momentum, sustained political momentum, and now the Trade Facilitation Agreement is everywhere, everybody's talking about it, it's high on the agenda about the ratification. But what in 5 years, people will still need to talk about this, still put pressure, because the capacity especially in LDCs is limited, and if other priorities come, there may not be sufficient pressure to continue working on this. So what is, and then we also need this political commitment to resist resistance, because of course there'll be lots and lots of winners from the Trade Facilitation Agreement in an LDC, but there may be the occasional loser. For example, somebody who has a monopoly production and is worried about competition coming, or those who benefit from long container dwelling times because they actually rent out those spots. So you need political commitment to address those changes that are necessary. There are two more. One is, customs is driving this agenda, but there are other border agencies that are involved. And, their implementation capacity may be lower because they haven't been at the forefront of trainings. And also the inland border points may be particularly difficult to reach for the required changes. Now, what about the challenges in financing the trade facilitation agreement? Here, I differ a little bit with my predecessor. A lot of funding has been made available for trade facilitation over the last decade, and then for the trade facilitation agreement in particular. The World Bank has windows, the WTO has its fund, various bilaterals are really focused on this, including, you know, the government of my own country, Germany. The Global Alliance was launched today. So there is, I think, especially for LDCs that are again the most vulnerable and those the donors are most are favoring for initiative. I think the funding for developing the new legislation, setting up new departments, you know, the hardware for automated systems, for advanced lodgement, single window equipment, capacity building, I think the funding will be available. However, there is a challenge of accessing that. And this is something we've seen in the EIF. Some countries don't have the capacity to access a capacity building program. So they need to some help in order to formulate a project proposal, you know, to the standards that are required by these windows. So you know, this is very important, and yes, because some of these facilities that are available, they have sort of competition for funding. So the best proposal gets, or you know, 50 proposals get sent in. They can fund 20, and of course they select the best ones. Now that means that those that have the least capacity to write proposals may not get there. So this is important to see that everybody gets access to these funding opportunities, not just those that are already you know, quite well, you know, equipped or better equipped than others. And so now, how can the, you know, what is my own program, the EIF? How can we help LDCs in this context, addressing the implementation capacity and the financing? Now, we actually have a mandate in the Trade Facilitation Agreement, and our mandate is to promoting coordination for assistance to LDCs in support of the Trade Facilitation Agreement to ensure maximum effectiveness of and results from this assistance. And you know, the way we interpret this is that not just, you know, letting the countries know what programs are there, but also to help them access this funding through capacity building measures that we fund with our own resources. But not just, you know, the capacity building we provide is not just, you know, to write a proposal to receive technical assistance, but also, you know, we see ourselves as a program that provides resources to the countries, you know, for awareness raising about the power of trade to be an engine of growth and poverty elimination. So, and as the general population, the stakeholders, as they become more familiar with the potential of trade, then they will generate that push for government to have the political commitment to continue pushing for the implementation of the agreement. I'd mentioned earlier that, you know, maybe this momentum could, you know, could become less over the years, but if there is from the private sector, from other stakeholders, if there is this demand to implement this agreement, you know, that particular constraint can be addressed. So, and then lastly, I wanted to talk about a little bit this you know, import facilitation agreement. It's good if imports get cheaper through the implementation of the Trade Facilitation Agreement. That's great for the population. If goods get cheaper, there are lots of producers that need imports, so they become more competitive. And a lot of exporters, especially in LDCs, also use imports. So this isn't bad. However, we also want, of course, to benefit from the Trade Facilitation Agreement implementation through increased exports, so that the LDCs can finally increase their share of exports beyond this meager 1 to 2%, depending on whether or not you include tourism. So the EIF is a holistic program. We look not just at trade facilitation, we also look at the at capacity building of the export value chains. So as you know, since this is part of the agenda, but not the only agenda, we make sure that the other points get addressed as well. Now, some of you may know we had our pledging conference on Monday, and we raised $90 million for the second phase of the program. That's good news in these austere times, but it's not enough for what had been estimated for the second phase of the program. It's about a quarter to a third of what we need, and it's just a fraction of what the LDCs need to address their wider aid for trade needs. So the financing constraints, in my view, are not so much for the Trade Facilitation Agreement itself, but actually for those activities that need to accompany the Trade Facilitation Agreement. And here I'm in complete agreement with my predecessor, those accompanying measures that need to be taken so that LDCs can fully benefit from the implementation of this Trade Facilitation Agreement through growth of exports and the related employment generation to transformation of their economies. And let me stop here.
Thank you, Dr. Christian, for highlighting implementation and financing challenges of TFA and also highlighting the mandate and the activities of EIF also. Well, I mean, let me clarify what our ambassador, I'm also from Nepal, that's why I'm just trying to clarify what our ambassador Deepak Dital said. Here, I mean, particularly for Nepal, if you look at our import structure, you don't find import of capital goods or import of intermediate inputs or, for that matter, import of raw materials. But what we are importing is basically for final consumption. And this had not added or contributed to our export. And the risk for us is this input structure sustainable for the long run? That's our concern. Well, let me invite Dr. Mia Mikic. Madam, you have the chair.
Thank you very much, Posh. Well, I know that this has been a long 3-4 days, and you are here to actually ask your questions and share your experiences. So let me try not to be very long here. I would like to address three points, if I may, Chair. First, I would like to go back to the notion of trade costs and why it's important to know how they are made, what are they made of, and how high or not they are, particularly for the least developed countries, and then also to look at the very specific analytical tool that we have developed in terms of understanding better some components of these trade costs related to trade facilitation, and then lastly, I would like to look at the results of our survey that our regional commission, together with other regional commissions, have done across globally and regionally, and to look at to what extent already countries have implemented various trade facilitation measures, and then tie it back into the still a need for financing and capacity building to progress from that point. So let me talk very fast about these things, and to facilitate my presentation, I have left a number of handouts in the back table because we are not allowed to to use PPTs here, yet I'm dealing with certain figures, etc. So I have a little reminder myself here. Now, first, when we talk about trade costs, and trade costs have been mentioned over the last 3 days number of times in different contexts. You know, in one sense, it was said that this is the only remaining problem that countries have in terms of joining into the global economy, and therefore we need to focus on how to reduce these trade costs. And this is well said. This is true. But we need to understand what they are made of, and we have done together with the World Bank an analysis in terms of quantifying trade costs for over 180 countries across the globe. The data set is available both on our ArtNet website, but also on the World Bank data bank or development indicators. And so just to give you a notion of what these trade costs are made out, if you take any level of the cost as 100%, then about 10 to 30%, on average 22%, goes on the category of geographical and cultural factors that are simply there, and probably there is nothing to be done to remove that. And then on the other end, there is about 0 to 10% going on the tariffs that sit at the border. So in between, we have squeezed a space of about 60 to 90% that is called policy-related non-tariff trade costs, right? And these are made out of the following categories: direct, behind, and at the border trade costs, availability and use or difficulty in use of ICT services, business and regulatory environment. These come to about less than 15%, right? Then we have looked at the category that is related to maritime connectivity and services related to that. That, depending on a country, goes between 15% and 18%. So the largest category left, about 52 to 57% of trade costs, is other trade costs. And what is there? Right. So these are indirect costs of trade procedure, currency fluctuations, and other non-tariff barriers. So this is where the problem lies, right? It's in something that is very hard to negotiate away, because if you look at the agreements, whether they are preferential at the bilateral level, regional level, whether they are still sitting in around the WTO table, they do not directly look into these issues, and then also very often what we find, they are actually domestic regulatory issues. Therefore, you don't actually need to negotiate with anyone to remove these, because they are self-made, and you can therefore self-remove them through the unilateral policy changes. So this is about the structure of the cost. We have measured, as I said, these costs for agricultural products, for industrial products, and then we have also done some averaging out for the overall trade costs. And what is found is that very often the trade cost of the least developed countries, or some, or definitely Pacific Island countries, and some of the landlocked developing countries, are higher when they try to trade with the neighboring country or with the country in the sub-region than when they are actually trading with a faraway developed market, right? And this is what then, of course, prevents the sub-regional regional integration, and perhaps is also what causes this perennial existence of the structure of trade that that goes to the developed markets that is then based on the final goods rather than something else. So let me stop on the trade cost there. There is of course in addition to the database, there are analytical papers that you can find on our website of the Asia Pacific Trade and Training Research Network on Trade, where the methodology and everything else is fully explained. So typically what we find, the trade costs are high. What do you, and they are caused by regulatory procedures, by non-tariff barriers mostly. So how do you go about reducing them? Well, we have looked at various various possible paths to finding out how, and we have designed an analytical tool called business process analysis, where we go to the field and actually track the product, the selected product, from the production point to the consumption point, and measure the number of days and number of procedures and the cost related to that for on its journey from the production to the consumption. Some people would want to say also what happens after the consumption is done, whether you want to actually make it circular and go into recycling, reuse, reconditioning, but we haven't done that part yet. So we have collected the data of all our research, and it's available also on our site for more than 15 countries in the region, and for I think it was 27 products, where we have found that the biggest hurdle that various products that we have tracked, but we have averaged that out across all of these products, are the following: documentary requirements, inadequate physical infrastructure at ports of entry and exit, unreliable regulatory information, duplicate procedures, corrupt practices at ports, lack of use of modern technology for information sharing between government agencies, lack of coordination between government agencies and Chamber of Commerce, and the last one, but still relatively important, inadequate access to export finance. So as you can see, all of these are actually sitting at home, and are maybe some are simply removed or reduced in their influence by better coordination between government agencies and by providing sufficient information to the traders, right? But some, of course, when they deal with infrastructure, et cetera, require further investment, where the EIF comes in and gives hands in doing these things. So now, once you understand what sort of source of the problem is in sending the product to the destination, then you need to attack it with particular policies and measures, right? I'm sorry that we haven't actually gone into the services and haven't looked into that, but that's another story altogether. So coming quickly to the third point that I wanted to take with you is to present the results of our survey across 44 countries in the region, in Asia Pacific. The results are also available for African countries because they're done in cooperation with our sister agency, Commission for Africa, and as well as for other regions. And so what we have designed a survey of 38 trade facilitation measures, including also some related to the cross-border paperless trade, which is our little initiative that we pursue in Asia Pacific, but I'm not going to talk about that. And we have went to the countries, asked them about the level to to give a judgment, the experts, the regulators, the traders, etc., to give us the impression of on the range from 0 to 4, how much of the certain facilitation measure has been implemented, and then after collecting these results and analyzing them, we have went back to the government and the various agencies to validate the data, and so what is presented here is validated by those government relevant government agencies. So out of the measures that of course are related to the trade facilitation agreement of the WTO, because that was our focus, and we grouped them in measures of transparency, formalities, and institutional arrangement and cooperation. The findings are quite interesting, actually. Across the region, we find great variety in implementation. Some of the small countries, small island countries, haven't implemented even 15% of those measures. If I may provide a result for Nepal, Posh. Nepal is sitting at around 25% of implementation of these countries. But we do have countries that are sitting close to 100%, right? And they are not necessarily only developed countries. For example, Cambodia and Laos have done a much well in terms of implementation. In general, if you look at the subgroups of the countries, for obvious reasons, Pacific Islands are doing the worst, and the landlocked developing countries are doing the best. So the least developed group is in between, and then in terms of the sub-region of Asia and Pacific, East Asia and Southeast Asia, of course, are doing much better than the other sub-regions in Asia. The least implemented measures, which I think came to my surprise, were on electronic single window systems and the establishment and publication of average release times and things that you would expect would score better, because there is so much effort that has been actually put into automatization of customs procedures and all other things. Let me close only by saying that if countries would actually go from this average of for Asia Pacific in total of 55% implementation to the full implementation, we would expect those trade costs that I said we estimated would fall by 16 to 17% on average, which, depending on how do you then calculate the changes in export, could bring more than $300 billion of export to the whole region, right? So let me stop at this, and I will be willing to provide further details if necessary.
Thank you, Dr. Mia. Well, Dr. Mia has highlighted the work of UNSCAP on trade cost, and also the assessment of trade facilitation in the SCAP region. She also provided a breakdown of trade cost, and argued that more than half of the trade cost is associated with trade facilitation, including non-tariff barriers. Well, so let me open the floor for question, clarification. I request you to identify yourself. Please.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, my name is Moses from Nigeria. I'm very impressed with all the presentations. Mm. I purposely came here because of this topic. I'm interested in it. It's gladdening to hear that it's not a matter of lack of funds. It's a question of how to access the funds. We have been told that there is funding provided in various organizations and donor bodies for funding trade implementation of TFA. And we were also told that the constraint, major constraint, is the capacity to access these funds. Why don't we now focus on the building the capacity, put our energies strongly? And in my region, West Africa, I discovered that there are so many agencies doing so many things. You have the GIZ, you have USAID, you have so many, and it's like uncoordinated. These activities are uncoordinated. And so because of that, they don't have impact. And they have timelines. After 2 years, after 3 years, a program ends, and that's the end of it. You have to start sourcing for funding to continue such TFA projects. So I want a situation whereby there's collaboration among all the donor agencies and agencies that are empowered to fund the TFA implementation. Then secondly, I would suggest another source of funding. It's been mentioned that the developed countries, the powerful countries, they seem to benefit more from the weaker countries economically. But I discovered that it is in the best interest of everyone, whether strong or weak, that trade should be facilitated. So in the interest of, we call it enlightened self-interest, the developed nations should put measures together to make sure that whatever funding they can get. Something that comes to my mind is what somebody mentioned yesterday in another forum, that illicit funds coming out of the developed countries. We cannot hide that because we are saying that there's no money, yet money are going out into the developed countries from the developing countries. Such money, I know that the developed nations are trying to repatriate some of these monies back to the developing nations. Why don't we assess such funds and give a condition that this should be used for trade facilitation funding? The government can do it at a very higher level. It's something that could be discussed at the level of WTO, UN, and whatever other organizations. So funding is not a problem. It's how to go about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So let me collect other comments or questions, and I'll ask the panelists to respond.
Yeah, my name is Daniel from the private sector, and I would wish to maybe get some insight, maybe from Dr. Maya, on how the private sector can access this fund. Is it that this fund is only given to the government per se, or what is the criteria? Is the private sector allowed to apply, or what are the, you know, the guidelines that backs that funding? And two, are there specific areas that the private sector can access that fund for? Thank you.
Thank you, panel. I think all the three interventions, including the comments by the chair, were very well received. Thank you for that. In one of the sessions, the point was made that trade facilitation, even if we have the trade facilitation at the border, the services facilitation is very important because in many of the trade in goods, services are embedded. So if you have, in the sense of the definition that has been used in the WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement, mostly it is customs, you know, customs facilitation, and the 38 points that are there, mostly it's clearance, paperless trade, single window, and all those things. But if you don't have services facilitation in the sense of the banking and insurance and all those electronic transfer of funds, all those things, then trade facilitation itself will not do that trick. So I would like to get the views of the panelists with regard to this aspect of trade facilitation in the broader sense of the word. Thank you.
Please.
Thank you very much. My name is Sophie Flinsborg from the ICTSD, as I mentioned before. I just wanted to pick up on your comment because in the E50 initiative, the expert group that were looking at trade finance actually looked at the idea of creating a trade facilitation understanding for services. In other words, this agreement that we have now, the trade facilitation agreement that we're talking about now, addresses goods, but what about the services? So not only the services that are required for exporting goods, but also the services themselves as a traded service that could be exported as well. So that's, I just wanted to bring your attention this idea and see, you can find more about the idea on our website, but there is actually reflection about how can we facilitate trade and services going on right now. Thank you.
Please.
Thank you. I'm called Mola. I'm a business manager with the KCB Bank Group, a regional bank. Quite intriguing to hear that actually over 50% of trade costs is actually non-tariff and other trade costs. I just wanted maybe you clarify for businesses, especially small businesses in, let's say, a country like Kenya, because I meet them every day. When let's say they come for financing, let's say they want to do exportation or they want to do importation, and they really don't have access to information to probably institutions that actually deal with promotion of this kind of trade we're talking about. Because they will really want to have access to this kind of funding, but they don't have information. Then secondly, how will you link the various institutions that deal with the trade promotions and facilitation with the mainstream financial institutions? This is the private, like the private financial institutions, because financial institutions, they act like one-stop shop. When a client or a business wants financing, they're more likely to walk into a bank than probably a non-governmental organization, because they know at the bank they're going to get information from A to Z. So how do you probably link whatever you do with private organizations so that customers can have access to that? Thank you.
Please.
Thank you very much. My name is Tahir Idris. I come from Nigerian Shippers Council. I want to re-echo this issue of accessibility of funds, like my colleague has done, but with particular reference to a particular project. Now, Nigeria as a coastal state has the international obligations to assist the landlocked countries. We have two neighboring us, Chad and Niger Republic. In an effort to facilitate the free flow of their transit cargo through Nigeria, we embarked on a number of projects. We've been assisting, we've been facilitating. My organization is the economic regulator in the port sector. Now, we have two projects which are bedeviled with a lot of problems, which we feel can benefit from some of these financing sources. One, and both of them are meant to facilitate the free flow movement of Niger and Chad cargo through Nigeria. One of them is the establishment of dry ports, inland container depots, close to the border with the borders with these two landlord countries. Gone are the days when government will establish such a facility on its own. It has to be private partnership with the private sector. But then, even then, we've been trying to promote this kind of project for the last almost 10 years. It's still yet to take off. Another project also meant to serve the same purpose, is the establishment of truck transit parks along the corridor, say from Lagos to Kano to Jibia, up to inside Niger, and then from Lagos to Maiduguri to Chad. This is another capital project but that needs financing. And we've raised this issue in another forum this morning. We were told that Nigeria cannot possibly benefit from that particular funding they are talking in that forum because we are not among the least developed nations. But here is a coastal state, a port state, that is trying to assist its landlocked neighbor, which is almost 1,000 kilometers away from the coast. Over 1,000, the border itself is about 1,000 kilometers away from the coast, and trying to establish facilities dedicated for that facilitation. Yet funding is becoming a problem. Now, the question is whether through some other, we phrase it there, they said we are not least developed, so we can't. We can only tell the neighboring landlocked countries to access it. But they probably cannot access to establish a facility in Nigeria for the facility, transportation of their cargo. We're talking of assistance to Nigeria to establish those facilities under whatever conditions, reasonable conditions, so that we can properly facilitate in line with the trade facilitation efforts that we're willing. Well, then we have these constraints. I want this forum to look at the possibility of financing some of these well-intentioned projects towards assisting the least developed countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Or maybe our panelists would respond to these issues, and if time allows us, we'll have second round of questions. Well, let me start with Dr. Christian. Okay, there are many yeah. funding issues.
Yes, thank
and
you.
And you are on top of it.
Thank you very much. Now, let me first clarify that there are specific funding windows set up to address the implementation of the Trade Facilitation Agreement. And what's necessary for the implementation of the Trade Facilitation Agreement are some hardware, but mostly what we call sort of software trade facilitation support, that's training, capacity building, technical assistance. The envelopes aren't enormous, but the needs are mostly also not that great, because it's a lot cheaper to run a capacity building program, training customs officials and other border officials, compared with building a dry port, building a truck transport park, let alone road or rail networks. For those bigger projects that was mentioned in Nigeria, that would then be the normal bilateral and regional aid programs, where the World Bank and the African Development Bank are very active. It's a question of what's the priority for the development of this project within the country in the discussions with those donors. In terms of something was mentioned by Moses from Nigeria, who said there are so many different programs and, where's the coordination? And for the Trade Facilitation Agreement, there are actually a number of agencies that help to coordinate. The WTO as a trade facilitation facility and team, they are there also to point the countries towards other sources. And the same thing here, the EAF would probably not use its funding for something for which other countries have envelopes, but we would direct the LDCs to these fundings, and if it's necessary to provide them with expertise to prepare a project proposal, that would also be then something that we could make available if this is not included in that particular envelope. But so, you know, it's right, there are a lot of different options out there, but, you know, for the WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement, their team, would be the first port of call. If you are an LDC, then we would also be helpful. Can the private sector benefit, and this is the last question that I'll address, there is, I've mentioned this Global Alliance for Trade Facilitation that was funded this morning, and this is actually a public-private partnership that's set up in order to focus in particular on the private sector to help implement the trade facilitation agreement, to be represented in the national trade facilitation agreements and so on and so forth. And so this is something that I can recommend to follow up. I don't know a lot about this myself yet. It's just been launched today. There may be some material still around, and certainly this will be advertised, I guess, tomorrow in the press. That's something that's quite promising. Thank you very much for all the interesting questions, but we're running out of time, so thanks. I'm giving the floor to others.
Thank you. Ambassador Dittal.
So thank you for all your queries and observations. And there was very interesting issues raised. And one of the issues that was raised by Ms. Marshall's Nigeria is the lack of coordination in the utilization of funds and the various development activities in many developing countries and LDCs. This has become a problem indeed. And well, there have been a lot of efforts, like the Paris Principle is there, and it really gives emphasis that the country becomes, at the driver's seat and with full ownership and coordination from the recipient country itself, the programs and projects can be handled and they can give better results. Collaboration is is really very needed, and there are multiple players involved, and the private sector, and there are also now a lot of measures in innovative financing, the public-private partnerships, all this. There are so many measures already and mechanisms already in place, but still for those countries which are at the bottom rung of the development ladder, coordination has always become a problem. And so it needs to be addressed with open mind. That is one thing. And with regard to the service facilitation issue, yes, for LDCs, even for LDCs, services are becoming a very important segment of the economy. They represent, in case of Nepal, around 51% of the GDP. So it's increasingly become very, very important. And whenever there are goods and their movement, all this export, import is concerned, the services automatically comes. And so I think it is high time that, component is also factored in and treated in a holistic manner. So far, the provisions of the TFA are concerned. They are, I fully agree with you that, mostly concerned with merchandise imports and exports. But I think it is something which need to be introduced and probably, you know, in the term, as we move along with implementation of TFA, this will automatically enter at some point of time and be a part and parcel of it. And one very interesting, you know, being an LLDC, Nepal itself, you know, my country where I come from, this very interesting issue of how we can collectively fund for infrastructure development. That has always become an issue of importance for us. Well, there is this LLDC and the transit developing countries through which, through the territory of which, you know, the cargo vehicles of landlocked countries get access to the sea. And if they, the transit developing countries, do not come out with real cooperative spirit, the landlocked countries will be at a mess. They cannot really do anything. You know, their whole prospect of international trade, you know, it goes haywire. It doesn't function. That difficult situation, you know, even Nepal we are experiencing from time to time. And well, the Vienna program of action, you know, with all these six priority areas, which also focuses on fundamental transit and trade policy issues, as well as development and upgradation of infrastructure that is jointly used by transit developing countries as well as the landlocked countries. Well, that is a very important issue, a concept that has been brought forward, but I haven't seen any effective mechanism of building and upgrading infrastructure, you know, in collaboration with landlocked country and transit development countries. There are some efforts. Sometimes when there are missing links, you know, just to establish that or doing a small part of some infrastructure, but that also is in isolation. And there are certain gaps we have seen, you know, in many LDC and transit developing countries case. Well, this component of Vienna Program of Action actually needs to be seriously addressed. And without external resources, I think it's not possible to build a quality, old standard infrastructure that really, you know, helps bringing down the cost of doing trade. Well, you know, there are some best practices, good examples set elsewhere. You know, one example could be, for example, Switzerland. You know, it's now a well land-linked country. So it is land-linked, and there is no problem. Even adjoining countries utilize the quality infrastructure that is available within Switzerland. It can happen. It's a classic example. Many LLDCs, they are very poor, very marginalized. They have hardly any funds available for quality infrastructure if they do not access it from external sources. ODAs, now it's not enough. And the international financial institutions, international as well as regional institutions, they are also becoming very important. Apart from that, you know, these countries also need to develop certain measures to address the fundamental trade and transit facilities sharing issues. There should be no misunderstanding. Otherwise, you know, it becomes very, very costly for LDCs, LLDCs. Thank you. I think that's my...
Okay, thank you. Dr. Mia.
I will be very short. Just a couple of specific questions. I think while enhanced integrated framework is dealing with the aid for trade for the least developed countries, obviously other countries can get access to aid for trade in general. And there are bilateral donors, I'm not going to name them, but maybe privately I can tell you, that actually prefer to directly fund private sector, not go through the government. And that is one of the issues which we have in monitoring aid for trade, because when it goes directly to the private sector and it's not registered by the government, then there are discrepancies in the numbers and also not weakness in the evaluation and measuring of impacts, etc. Right? But it's possible to get that. In terms of the linking transit and countries with the landlocked countries and the projects, I think what we have at present in Southeast Asia, right, is the experiment. Or the project that we are trying to work out with the Asian Development Bank on how to actually facilitate the trade of agricultural products from the landlocked countries, working through and investing in facilities in the transit countries, and it's going very slowly. And the reason why it's going slowly, it was mentioned here, but because there are political issues and there are borders, and they can always get in a way of cooperation. But the one good way to go about it is to strengthen and deepen regional integration. And once you have that, like a single market, then obviously you would have much less problem with that issue, right? I think there are possibilities, but obviously it's not a walk in a park, and it's a complex issue. Let me stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mia. Now we are towards the end of the session. And at the end, I don't want to summarize what it is discussion we had in this session, but would like to highlight some of the issues I would love to take home. The first, an implementation of TFA, Trade Facilitation Agreement, could bring substantial cost reduction for traders in developing countries as well as in least developed countries, thereby reducing deadweight loss and supporting increased economic activities and potentially also increasing revenue for the government. However, we need to address trade facilitation in broader perspective and broader framework, including hard infrastructure related to trade facilitation, services related to trade, and also inclusion of facilitation of trade in services itself. Second point, developing and least developed countries are facing many challenges implementing TFA. There is a lack of understanding of trade facilitation measure among policymakers as well as among private sector. Political commitment for the implementation of TFA and resistance to directly unproductive rent-seeking activities is also lacking. There is coordination failure among government agencies and also between government agencies and the private sector. And the successful implementation of reforms requires cooperation between government agencies and private sector. Another point, some of the measures such as the single window and hard infrastructure, development of hard infrastructure are very resource incentive. That is, it requires financial, technological, institutional, or human resources for the implementation. And the domestic actors, particularly private sector and the government, alone cannot meet these costs. Donors should contribute sufficient resources to help countries achieve the desired result of this trade facilitation agreement. Many development partners, including multilateral, bilateral development partners, are providing support in areas of trade facilitation. WTO has recently initiated trade facilitation agreement facility. I think, Samini, it is a step in right direction. But taking into account the resource requirement for the implementation of TFA and the development challenges of developing and least developed countries, establishment of trade facilitation fund at the global level dedicated to support developing and least developed countries in the implementation of TFA would go a long way in reaping benefits of trade facilitation agreement. Well, with this note, I thank you all for your very creative and productive contribution in the debate. Thank you. Thank you very much.